Namaskar. I am not very expert like you all. I am a very ordinary man to be here with you. I feel extremely privileged to present myself, a humble Gandhian, before you and address this highly motivated group of IIT, IIM alumni, who are inspired by late Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam in his vision and mission to bring about social transformation in the society through partnership with corporate, government bodies, and civil society organizations. I think it is perhaps the first of its kind in Kolkata, and I am indeed elated to place my views and share my experiences as the keynote speaker in your August gathering. The theme of today's deliberation is unseen advantages and becoming agents of change. Taking a cue from the words of one of the greatest visionaries of our age, late Dr. Kalam, India is not an underdeveloped nation. It is highly developed nation in an advanced state of decay. We feel encouraged to say that India is gradually emerging as one of the biggest economies in the world, and primarily Dr. Kalam's unflinching faith in the youth of our country, that even after his demise, attempts are being made to translate his dreams into reality by all of you. It is an easier option to deliberate an advantage on advantages which are seen and palpable advantages which are time-tested and have been fruitful in the development process. Unseen advantages are difficult to identify and generally do not enter into the mindset of the entrepreneurs because we do not venture to explore them. That is where the challenges come in. We have to come forward and introduce our generation to these unseen advantages. Strategically speaking, it is the IITians and the IIM graduates who are the progenitors of these advantages, who, after passing out from their alma maters, enter into the world forum, having limited opportunities to offer from our country. This is because in our country there is lack of opportunities, competitive work environment, and the level of our technology is still not at par. Compared to the advanced countries, leading to inconvenience and unpredictable economic prospects, it is therefore necessary to turn these disadvantages into advantages and provide that platform where these young Turks can translate their ideas into building a technically advanced India. Our country has genuine expectation from them regarding their challenging expertise and innovative mindset, which would encourage new entrepreneurs to initiate startups in a large scale throughout our country so that industrial, agricultural, research and development, service sector, and social engineering, etc., can flourish and transform our country into a greater development, strong and confident nation. With that objective, our Honorable Prime Minister has left no stone unturned by repeatedly convening business conclaves with national and international industrialists, with the indigenous concept of Make in India, though it is very early to expect miraculous result, it is indeed a matter of concern that in the absence of venture capitalism, the country is suffering from shortage of investment. In my opinion, the future of our nation is banking on these IIM, IITians, who need to act as an agent of change by launching startups with the whatever investment corpus they have, along with the assistance from our banking system. The central government also has an elaborate plan to encourage this young entrepreneur to take up projects, even if these are in the small and even cottage industries section, because we believe that these industries have enough employment generating properties in the remotest part of the country, where big capitalists dare not enter in the absence of available infrastructure. Unfortunately, in our Kolkata also, to the big industries which have big presence in the city and its surroundings do not want to leave the comforts of the city life and explore the opportunities in the backward places, where there is surplus land availability of and labor ready to offer their services at lesser wages. Citing the case of West Bengal, where the government has declared a principle of not granting SEZ to any industry for concern that in doing so, it might be alienating local population who would be forced out of their hearth and home once an area falls under SEZ. Besides these properties problems, the state will get inadequate revenue from the entrepreneurs located within the state. Therefore, the state is looking for small-scale and cottage industries which would not require big chunk of land and will also provide greater number of employment near the homes of the laborers. The only problem they face is effective marketing of their products. The state has to take the onus of arranging the marketing of the products produced by the small scale and tiny industries which have export potential. In fact, the traditional cottage industries in Bankura, Purulia, Birbhum, and North Bengal have got wide international market, providing us good amount of foreign exchange. The government of India should come forward to protect not only the big industrialists, but offering them various incentives and tax concession, but also formulate policies to bring out optimum production from the small and these tiny industries. Such industries employ thousands of people without displacement and encourage them to develop strategies to market their products, earn revenues and make them sustainable and earn profit. It is through the empowerment of these entrepreneurs that we can facilitate the overall development of the nation. The country will make true progress only if the rural economy flourishes. This will in turn lead to infrastructural development of the villages and put a check on the problem of migration and unemployment. In this connection, I would like to mention that I, as president of Howrah Chamber of Commerce and Industry, it is one of the biggest chamber of commerce nowadays, because we have the first time we have taken an innovative project had dreamt to establish an eco-friendly industrial park in Howrah, where the unplanned micro and small industries of Howrah town, with obsolete and age-old equipment consuming excess energy, time, and cost of production, and without much scope for modernization, with efficient use of energy, could be shifted, relocated, and expanded with the view to rejuvenate the micro and small industries of the district, which was once known as Sheffield of India and Birmingham of East. With this dream, we established an eco-friendly industrial park in Howrah, where more than 325 micro and small enterprises members have purchased more than 600 acres of land individually and directly from the landowner to relocate and setting up their eco-friendly industrial units. The chamber has also intention of establishment of a new unit with expanded capacity with modern machineries to enable the entrepreneur to compete with the developed and developing countries in the liberalized and globally competitive market of future. This industrial cluster has been included in the National Innovative Council set up by the Honorable Prime Minister. It is the only one of such type of cluster from this state out of 400 clusters established in the country. In order to improve the life and living of people, especially the backward and underprivileged section of the society, it is not enough to give them items of relief only to ease the burden in their working life. But it is more important to improve the environment and standard of life through upgradation of their dwelling places and the amenities and requirements of their everyday living. This will help them to live a disciplined, systematically and hygienic life, which will promote their standard and quality of work and overall performance individually and collectively in the way scattered and waste spaces all around their dwelling habitation will be well utilized and to the advantage in community development. On a different note, deviating from my role as a president of a chamber of commerce, let me uphold the iconic and historic Horijon Sevak Sangh, an All India organization founded by Mahatma Gandhi in 1932, which has been working for the uplift of the downtrodden and the weaker section of the society through its numerous branches and affiliates across the country. The Sangh became the institutional edifice for translating into practice Gandhiji's ideas and inclusiveness, working for the achievement of its laudable aims by executing defined socio-economic development projects through its branches all over India. G.D. Birla was the first president of the Sangh, and he continued 27 years of this organization as president. Luminaries like Gandhiji, Thakur Baba, Mata Rameshwari Nehru, Nirmala Deshpande, they all were the president of this organization. The most remarkable landmark in the annals of the Sangh is that late Sri K.R. Narayanan, the former president of India, got his education through a residential ashram school in Kerala. And the Sangh further helped him in his higher studies. And late Sri Narayanan has mentioned this fact in his autobiography. And in several addresses, he emphasized that I am a product of Horijon Sevak Sangh. I am happy to mention that now I became the president of that organization. It is also worth mentioning that this Sangh also has been successful organizing training of youth rural entrepreneurs development program since 2005 to 2006 has so far trained more than 2,000 entrepreneurs who have invested almost 100 crores financed by the nationalist banks. All of them have set up their small industries in the rural areas. Dashang organized installation of 5,31,000 improved smokeless chullas in different villages of different districts of the state of West Bengal. The song also, along with the Tech Mahindra Group, established in Delhi a most ambitious project, Tech Mahindra Foundation Smart Academy, for which health for allied health professional in memory of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. It is our aim that by 2025, the academy will develop over 25,000 skilled professionals to offer healthcare services at India's leading hospitals. Let me finish in this context. We can state the father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi, opined that capitalism and socialism are unsustainable for addressing the problem of common man. On the other hand, parliamentary democracy, now accepted as the predominant statecraft throughout the Western world, has many shortcomings which make lives of dissidents and opponents of establishment difficult. Sarvodaya, which is built on the premises of human dignity and its ability to live in harmony among themselves without intervention of the state in the appropriate statecraft. Last but not the least, this cannot help orderly promotion of a civil society if we do not work for the dedicated worker, dedicated citizen of India, the concept of Bahu Jano Hitayo, Bahu Jano Sukhayo, of the Upanishad, meaning thereby the welfare for all. In this connection, you must always keep in mind the clarion call of Swami Vivekananda: arise, awake, and stop not, your goal is achieved. And emphasize the purpose of education of following the words: education is the manifestation perfection already in man. The alumni of IIT and IIM will be definitely inspired by this word. I quote, change yourself, you are in control. He sincerely believed that each one has find his peace from within, and peace in to be real must be unaffected and outside circumstances. The true sign of intelligence, according to Einstein, the true sign of intelligence is not knowledge, but imagination. Thank you.